Similarly, like that, well, sometimes we interpret the Bible a certain way to meet our needs. And when we unpack the story, we realize that God is asking each in us individually, well, do we want to get well? And what does that look like? And what does that look like as it relates to our own spiritual journey, as it relates to scripture, and as it relates to interacting with one another, regardless whether you are black or white or Republican or Democrat or libertarian, it doesn't matter. How do we get along? Do we want to be well? Do we want to live among each other in a healthy way? So it's good to be with you. I'm helping out in worship today. I got my car because I didn't want to forget anyone. We have Dan Bohrs, will be our liturgist. Caitlin Matson will be our hymn leader. And Caitlin and Chris, her mom, will have some special music for us today. So I invite you to quiet your heart, quiet your spirit, and allow the Holy Spirit to be present with us today. Welcome to worship.
Goodness, amen. Good morning. Please join in the call to worship. For those who feel comfortable, please stand. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it on the seas and established it on the waters. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not trust in an idol or a false god. They will receive blessings from the Lord and vindication from God, their Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of Glory may come in. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Who is he, this King of Glory? The Lord Almighty. He is the King of Glory. Please remain standing for our first hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns, found in the United Methodist Hymnal, number 327, or up on the screen.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne.
Please remain standing for our opening prayer. God of love, peace, and unity, we thank you for welcoming us all just as we are, for making us equal as your children from all corners of the earth, and for giving us your blessings as your children, and for making us belong. We pray that you help us realize that we are all made in your image, and we need to bring peace to all your creation as one people who belong to you. We ask all this through Christ, our brother. Amen. Now please join in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Loving God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. This morning's scripture comes from John chapter 5, verses 1 through 15. Listen now for the word of the Lord. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there is a pool, called in Hebrew, Bethesda, which has five porticos. In these lay many ill, blind, lame, and paralyzed people. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The ill man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, and while I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was a Sabbath, so the Jews said to the man who had been cured, "It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful for you to carry your mat." But he answered them, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Take up your mat and walk.'" They asked him, "Who is the man who said to you, 'Take up your mat and walk'?" Now the man who had been healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had disappeared in the crowd that was there. Later, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Do not sin any more, so that nothing worse happens to you." The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had made him well. God is still speaking.
Thanks, Dan. Let's pray. Gracious Eternal Father, we come before you once again. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for allowing us to be in this sanctuary. Thank you for another expression of your love, Lord. For there was those who went to sleep last night and that did not wake up this morning. But Lord, you allowed us to get up and to be clothed in our right mind to say thank you one more time. Lord, as I stand before you, I ask that you would empty me out as a vessel and that you would fill me up with your Holy Spirit, that the words that I speak would not be my own, would be through you. We thank you and we praise you. And in Jesus' names do I pray. Amen. So, how many of you have ever seen the movie, The Book of Eli? It was starts Denzel Washington. So, spoiler alert, if you are off this weekend, you may want to watch the movie. It is a good movie. It is about a post-apocalyptic world in which a lone man, Denzel Washington, kind of crosses the country and goes from the East Coast to the West Coast because of the Bible. His sole duty is to protect the Bible and get it over to the West Coast. And the reason he has to do so is because a voice told him that it held all the secrets of humankind. So here's a quote from the movie. Now the quote has some profanity in it, so I'm going to bleep it out. But you can use your imagination and figure out what the word is. It's not an flippin' book. It's a weapon. It's a weapon aimed right at the heart and mind of the weak and desperate. It's not a book. It's a weapon. It will give us control of them. If we want to rule more than this small one little town, this flippin' town, we have to have it. People will come from all over. They'll do exactly what we tell them to do. If the words come from the book. It's happened before, and it'll happen again. All we need is that book. Now, this statement is powerful because it reveals just how the Bible can be used or misused because of misinterpretation. For example, the Bible has been used throughout history for the colonization. It has been used to justify slavery, for the separation of the rich and the poor. It is also has been used in Germany in the 1930s for the rise of the right. Most of Jesus' frustration in Scripture comes through the religious leaders using Scripture incorrectly. Matthew 11:28 says, "Come unto me, all ye who labor and are heavy loaded, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart, and they shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." So Christ invites us to come into him, but to find rest, to find love, and to find hope. Not to be cast down, not to be spit on or mistreated. So briefly this morning, I want to take the story and I want you to think of it as a movie, and I have broken it down into three acts. Act one is the isolation of the marginalized. Act two is bad theology of the righteous. And act three is consequences of both. So let's look at the isolation of the marginalized, which is Act 1, chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there in Jerusalem was the sheep gate, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. So the story goes that there was an angel in the Bethesda pool, and either it was once a day or every so often, the angel would come down and it would stir the pool. And as the pool was being stirred, you had all these people who were lame or blind or an invalid. And if you got in the pool, when the angel has stirred it, you shall be healed. It goes on to say there was a great multitude of disabled. There were the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. But this particular man had been there. He had been an invalid for 38 years. So when he met Jesus, Jesus saw him laying there. He had learned of his condition, and he asked them a simple question. Do you want to be well? The guy replied, typically of humans, we make excuses of why things don't get done. It's like when you have kids and you come home and say, did you make the bed? Do you do the dishes? Do you do your homework? Well, no, mom, I couldn't because the power went out. No, mom, the water was too hot or the water was too cold. When we ask questions, sometimes we don't like the answer, so we make excuses. So he said, sir, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes ahead of me. So here are a few observations. Did the man really want to be healed? He had been there for 38 years. In fact, when you read it in the Greek, it's almost as if the man would come come there, spend all day there, wait for the pool to be stirred, someone else would get in before him, he missed his opportunity, and then he would go back. And then he kept doing this for 38 years. If you are in Christ, I would hope that if you've been walking with Christ for 38 years, you are not the same as you were when you first accepted. But Lord have mercy, we do have folks in the church that have been coming to the church for 38 years and are still the same. So it begs the question, do you even know Jesus? And if you do you even want to be healed, or are you satisfied the way that you are? Another observation is Jesus sees the man's isolation when he says, I have no one to put me in the pool. But yet, it says in Scripture, he is surrounded around people. How many times in our lives are we surrounded around people, but yet we are isolated? We are marginalized. None of those people could help this man get into this pool. It is very much possible to be in the midst of the crowd and in the midst of friends and yet still feel lonely. Still feel isolated, unnoticed, unloved, uncared for. Back then, people were isolated based upon their sickness, their condition. Now, we isolate people based upon their politics, their doctrine, their sexual ethics. Who did you vote for? Who do you sleep with? Where do you live? How much money do you make? This is how we have taken that same sickness and turned it in to the 21st century. Mother Teresa puts it this way: the greatest disease in the West today is not tuberculosis, is not leprosy, it is being unwanted, unloved, and uncared for. We have cured physical disease with medicine, but the only cure for loneliness, of desperation, of hopelessness, is love. She goes on to say, there are many in the world who are dying for a piece of bread, but there are many more dying for a little love. Poverty in the West is a different kind of poverty. It is not only a poverty of loneliness, but also of spirituality. There's a hunger for love as there is a hunger for God. How many broken relationships are there based upon this? I'm sure we can think of broken relationships in our family, our friends, coworkers, neighbors, church, community. How many are there? Depending on who you voted for, depending on who won, depending on whether you're too liberal or you're too conservative. Let's look at how Jesus responded to the poverty of this guy. First, the sheep gate, known as Bethesda, was the main entrance for those who literally needed to get to the pool. You know, the main entrance, who wants to come to a main entrance? If you ever have been to a concert before, you want to go through the VIP. You want to go to where there's no homeless people. You want to go, if you're a star, where there's no paparazzis. You want to get in, you want to get out, and you want to avoid the crowd. But Jesus went in through the main entrance, not as the disciples were going in through the VIP section, because he was going to where the people were. He was going to where the lame, the marginalized, the blind, the ugly, the smelly, the stinky, the Republicans, the liberals, the Democrats, the independents, the vegetarians, the meat lovers. He was going to where his people were. So how did Jesus respond? Well, Jesus noticed the guy. The first thing it says that Jesus sees him, Jesus moved towards him, then Jesus showed him more than sympathy. He didn't give him a dollar. He didn't say, here, don't go buy drugs or cigarettes with this. Go do something with your life. Go get a job. No, he healed the man. He saw the man, he moved towards the man, and then he healed the man. When the guy says, I have no one to help me in the water, in essence, Jesus demonstrated that the man really didn't need the water. All he needed was Jesus. So he said, get up, take your mat, and walk. Sometimes all people need is Jesus, and they won't find it in the house of God because they won't set foot in this place because of a normal, for various reasons. However, if Christ is in you, you can take folks to Christ through you and Christ. In fact, it is Christ who lives in us. And because of that, because Christ lives in us, it is the hope of glory. This is why we have opportunities during the redevelopment to give back to those who are less fortunate, because in that is the hope of glory. This is why we have a mission community, a mission team here at the church. This is why we have opportunities to go out and to volunteer and to call those who are sick, to be there who are shut in. This is all part of the ministry of Jesus. We see people, we move towards people, and we love people. We don't give them a litmus test and say, well, where are you on this abortion issue? Where are you on the death penalty? Where are you on LGBTQ? Where are you on this? Who did you? No. We see people if Christ lives in us. We don't have to agree with everyone. Jesus didn't agree with everyone. And I can tell you this, a lot of people didn't agree with Jesus. But yet they accepted him as his Lord and Savior. So Jesus shows us how to go about being in relationship with others. How to go providing the healing nature. First, we ought to see people. Then we ought to enter in relationship with people. Have you ever been to a party or out somewhere and you meet someone and they just criticize you, whether it's criticize you at your job or criticize you for what you eat? We have to stop and pause and see people the way God has made them. And then enter into a relationship, enter into a conversation, not to change their views, but just to get to know them. Jesus saw the man, he moved towards the man, and then he healed the man. We ought to see people, we ought to move towards people. And then as people begin to get healed, we don't praise ourselves, but yet we point to Christ, who is the source of their healing. And whether that healing is inviting them to have a personal relationship with Christ, whether that healing is providing them with money or finances or food or giving them a ride to work or sending them a car for their birthday or being with them when they had a death in the family, whatever that healing looks like in that time, you see them, you move towards them, you give them that love, but yet you point to Jesus, who is the source. Christians here at Belmont must be the source of healing and not the problem. Christians must bridge the divide and not create conflict. Christians in this community must be a part of the healing. At the end of Act 1, we see the guy being healed. So that could be the end of the story, and I could just be done with the sermon, but I still have two more acts to go. It's kind of like when you see the movie, and it's like, all right, man, the good guy wins. Well, in Act 1, the good guy wins. Let's look at Act 2. Act 2 is verses 10 through 13, and I've labeled it Bad Theology of the Righteous. The first thing the religious leaders said after they saw the man healed, it's the Sabbath. You're breaking the law. The guy had been there for 38 years. He had no one to help him in the pool, yet he was surrounded by those who were lame, those who were paralyzed, those who were invalid, but he was also surrounded by the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the religious leader. Well, I can give an excuse for the folks that were sick. The sick person was like, well, I need to get in for my healing so I can't help you. But what's the excuse for the religious leaders, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees? They didn't see the guy, but yet they saw him when he was healed. Not to say, praise the Lord, look what God has done, but to point their finger and say, it's the Sabbath, dude. What are you doing walking with your mat? What are you doing with your healing on the Sabbath? Who do you think you are? You're breaking the law. This verse is the crux of the entire event because it reveals how people life-giving, their devotion to Jesus, sometimes is pushed aside to be righteous, to be right. Let's get some context to what the Pharisees and Sadducees and religious leaders were talking about. Because if we're interpreting scripture correctly, they just didn't wake up one morning and say, hey, I think we ought to beat up people that do things on the Sabbath. No, they're getting it from somewhere. And in this case, they are upset because he's carrying his mat, and they're getting this from Exodus 28 through 11. I'm going to read it. It says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord, your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male, nor your female servant, nobody. Your dog can't, if you have a fish, they need to stop swimming, and the frog can't jump. Nothing can happen on the Sabbath. Nor your animals, nor the foreigners, nor your visitors. For 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is there within it, and he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath and made it holy. Exodus 8 through 11. So it sounds simple, but it's not. What do we mean by work? Well, the Pharisees are upset because the man has been healed, so Jesus has healed him on the Sabbath, and the man is quote-unquote working on the Sabbath. So he literally obeyed Jesus. He was healed, pick up your mat, walk, go home, take a shower, do what you got to do, go find a job, but he's carrying his mat. The religious experts put their heads together, and this is called the Mishnah. And in the Mishnah, in Jewish culture, there are 39 categories of what it means to work. And out of the 39 categories, there's a commentary for each category. So you get that. So if you take the word work, there's, for that work, if you were to dissect it, there are 38 synonyms, so to speak, of what work means. And for the 38 synonyms, there are 38 commentaries of how to define it. So, in the Mishnah, from the religious leaders, this is what it means. To work means to carry, burning, extinguishing, finishing, writing, erasing, cooking, washing. How many of you washed your hands today, took a bath today? I hope all of you have sinned on the Sabbath now. Sewing, tearing, knotting. I just saw some nods. You have also sinned on the Sabbath. Sharpening, selecting. Did you select what you're going to wear today? You have sinned. You should have just woke up, reached in the drawer, whatever you put on, and came to church. But no, you put conscious effort into it, so you have worked. Widowing, plowing, weeping, combing. Well, some people combed their hair, some people didn't, so some of you sinned, some of you didn't. Spinning, dyeing, change seating, slaying, weaving, building, trapping, tanning. Sun's not out that much, so no tanning. Making, smoothing, and demolishing. And that was only 29. Done, but we're not done. Let's get back to the first one. Carrying was the first one I mentioned. Remember, this is what the Pharisees was upset about, because he was carrying his mat. Since people were forbidden to select or to carry on the Sabbath, the man had broken the law. The only exception was carrying things inside your home, and it must not weigh more than a fig leaf. So if he had a mat that weighed less than a fig leaf, he still would have sinned because he wasn't inside his home. Who can live by that? So the Sabbath police, let's call them the Sabbath police, the religious leaders, the Sabbath police, are upset because he has violated carrying his mat. So they immediately get up and they're like, they didn't get up to rejoice, they got up to question, who did this? You sinned, but whoever healed you sinned as well. Two observations. They are the Sabbath police because they don't see people until they break theology. Sometimes we don't see people until they sin. Sometimes we don't see people until they're broken. Sometimes we don't see people until we have heard about their gossip, until we have heard about all the crap, so we have heard about, oh man, they're worse off than we are. Then we see people. The reason the religious leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the doctoral police, the reason they didn't see the guy, because they're looking for sinners. They're looking for people that have done wrong. They're not looking for the joys. They're not looking for the hope. They're not looking to give love to people. They're not looking to give the peace of Christ to people. They're looking to point fingers. So that's one observation. Another observation would be they never saw him. They never saw the guy. How many of us take the same route every day? How many people, you know, I work at College of the Holy Cross. There's so many people at that school. And I'm the Protestant chaplain. And so I try to see people because one is my job. There's nine chaplains. We all have a different act. And so I try to remember students' names. I don't go up and say, hey, are you Catholic or Protestant? Because I only talk to the Protestant students because that's why they hired me. No. I go up and I say, hello, how are you? What's your major? I have conversations. Some people just want to be seen. Do you love people enough to know their name and to call them by name? The doctoral police could not see what God was doing because they weren't looking to see what God was doing. So the crux is revealed in John 9, and it says, as he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciple asked him, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus said, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. After saying this, he spat on the ground, made some mud with his saliva. He put it on the man's eyes and said, go, he told him, wash yourself in Siloam, wash yourself in the pool. So that the man went, he washed himself, and then he began to see. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was the Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked how he received his sight. He put mud, and so he said, he put mud in my eye with his saliva, and then he told me to go and wash my eyes, and then I had sight. Again, the Pharisees in John 9 were upset because Jesus had did a healing on the Sabbath. There are two views, two different views in how to interpret this. Camp one is Bible versus experience. The Pharisees knew scripture and knew the Jewish law, but their experience of what they were seeing wasn't adding up. So camp one is, I believe what the Bible says over my experience. And then camp two is, I believe what the Bible says, and I also have this experience as I walk among people who are not like me. So the Pharisee says, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But Bible and experience says, but other have asked, how can a sinner perform such signs? So they were divided. Why? So if you look at John 5, all the Pharisees and the Sadducees were together and blaming this guy. Said, you got healed. Jesus healed you. You carried your mat. You are a sinner. Shame on you. But in John 9, when Jesus broke the Sabbath again, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the doctoral police, the wall began to crack because Camp One says, wait a minute. How can he can't do that healing? It's a Sabbath. This man's not from God. But the other Pharisees, the other religious leaders that had that same conversation in John 5 was like, but wait a minute. The guy is healed. We see the guy walking. The guy can, so he healed this guy, and then he healed this other guy. Do you know why it was split? Well, the Bible says, in Matthew 7, 15 to 20, you will know them by their fruits. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. Therefore, when he had seen these tension, perhaps maybe, it isn't what we believe in the Bible, perhaps maybe, and kind of bringing this to Act 3, the Pharisees had an image of what they believed God was based upon the Jewish law, based upon what they thought was, we got to follow this to a T. But as Jesus began to do miracles and healings, and they start seeing things with their own eyes, there was a split among the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they begin to question, well, is it the Bible? No, the Bible doesn't lose its authority. It's not the Bible. It's your interpretation of the Bible. The Bible is still powerful. The Bible still does healing. Jesus still does healing. But your experience, you don't hold up the Bible and say, here is what the Bible says, and I'm going to hold my experience up underneath to see if I can believe what my eyes have seen, what my heart is telling me. Based upon this. No, you hold them both up and say, this is the word of God, and this is who God has made folks to be. This is my experience. And at the end of the day, you love people. You see people. You move towards people. Despite what they believe, despite how they vote, as long as they treat you right, as long as they don't physically attack you, as long as they're not cursing you out, then you get to know people. There's enough division in the world. Act 3, the consequences of both. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, this is Jesus after he healed the man carrying, you see, you are well again. Jesus said, stop sinning or something worse may happen to you. The man went away and he told the Jewish leaders that it was Jesus who had made him whole. Because after the Pharisees got on the guy, like, who did this to you? How'd you get healed? The guy didn't even know it was Jesus. He said, I actually don't even know. Like, he told me to pick up my mat, I got it, and then I actually don't know. So when he circled back around, he saw Jesus. And Jesus' advice to him was, stop sinning. And you know what the guy did? He went back and he threw Jesus underneath the bus. Yo, the dude you're looking for that caused all this stuff and caused your heart, that's that guy with the long hair, blonde hair, blue eyes, sandals. He's walking around. He's healing people. That's who did it. I didn't do anything. I was minding my own business, doing my whole can't walk, can't see, can't get into the pool by myself. And I was minding my own business. And then the guy came up. He told me to get up. He asked if he wanted to be healed. I said yes. He healed me. And here I am. This has nothing to do with me. This is between you and Jesus. I wonder how often do we throw Jesus underneath the bus. Sin has consequences. Paul said, we weep what we sow. If you go forth, if you go forth and you're in Christ, you take Christ with you. Take Christ with you on your job and your home and your arguments. Take Christ with you when you're high and you get promoted. Take Christ with you when you're alone and you're sick. We should take Christ with us everywhere. We walk with Christ because Christ is healing us, and we want to walk with others so others may be healed as well. We shouldn't give them a litmus test and figure out who I can hang out with and who I can't based upon the things, based upon social events and how people voted. And not just voted in the world, also voted in the church. Final thoughts. The story ends with the guy going to tell the religious leaders it was Jesus who healed him. Then the religious leaders went after Jesus, and that's how the story ended. Because shortly after that, that's when Jesus healed Lazarus from the dead, and that was the last straw for the Pharisees and the Sadducees, because once they realized that Jesus had the power over life and death, they crucified him. Our culture is very divided. Let's not be a part of the problem. Let's be a part of the solution. So I ask you, as Jesus asked the man there, do you want to get well? As you read scripture and as you come to church and as you interact with people in your community, are you getting closer to Jesus or are you getting away from Jesus? But we are never stagnant with Jesus. Our relationship with Jesus takes cultivating. We should read scripture. We should repent of sin. We should ask others for forgiveness. We should volunteer our time. We should volunteer our offerings. We should volunteer all the talents that Christ has blessed us with in whatever form or fashion that comes in. If you are a singer, sing. If you have the hands and ability to serve, then serve. But do it all for the glory of God. Do it to get closer with Christ. Don't be like the invalid and continue doing the same thing for 38 years and not moving close to Jesus. I want you all to move close to Jesus, because when you meet people who don't know Jesus, they will see the Jesus in you, which is the hope and glory which is found in you. Amen? Amen. At this time, we're going to move into sharing our prayers. For those that have prayer requests, I ask that you, you can either raise your hand or say them out loud. If you need a mic, we can get a mic to you. Okay. All right, let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for being a God that loves us so much. We thank you for those who are present on this fourth Sunday after Pentecost, on this 4th of July weekend. Lord, you know the hearts and minds of everyone that is in this room. You know their ups and their downs. We ask, Lord, that you touch. I ask that you would touch every family that is here today. I ask that you would be with Pastor Gary as he gets some rest, Lord, and rejoins us next Sunday. Lord, I thank you for safe travels back from burying my aunt and ask that you be with my family. I thank you for allowing me to get over COVID, Lord. And I thank you, most importantly, to be in the house of the Lord one more time. So, Lord, as we have heard the word, we ask that it would continue to penetrate our heart and how we live our lives. And that we would do things that would get closer to you every day. That we would repent of our sins. That we would love our neighbor and our brothers and sisters as ourselves. And that we would do things that would glorify you. Not that we would get the glory, but that we would point to you, which is the source. So keep us safe. Keep us humble. And keep us in your love. And in Jesus' name do I pray. Amen. We'll go into a prayer of dedication for those that have your tithes and your offerings and the various ways that you can do your tithes and your offerings, whether online or dropping a check off. Please join me as we do the prayer of dedication together. Gracious God, you provide us with opportunities every day to extol the dedication of this congregation, our faith family. Through our giving, we are able to support the vital ministries of this faith family. Bless these gifts and encourage us to be in the service in your holy name. Amen.
Our hymn is in the soft hymnal book in number 2171, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. Please stand if you're comfortable. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring you. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console.
Safe 4th of July, and hear the blessing. To him who was able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence with no fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ before all ages, now and forever. Amen.